talk of a control, that we say that our risk assessment is confirmed on the basis of sample, but actually it is not. Similarly, for substantive procedures, we say that the financial assertion, any of it, whether stock or data or for that matter plant and machinery, they are fairly stated, but if we put the procedures to the entire population, it is not. So that is called risk affecting audit effectiveness. Now this is very dangerous, because we are swayed by the result. When the result comes that everything is fine, we forget and go ahead. So this is the very something which is of concern for us. The other one is come to audit efficiency slide. Okay, the effective the errors affecting the audit efficiency. Now here the red light is on. If there is an error, that prompts us to do additional work. For example, when we take out a sample and the sample says it's called, also called incorrect under reliance or incorrect rejection. In case of internal control, it is called incorrect risk of under reliance, and in case of a substantive procedure, it is called incorrect rejection. In both cases, we perform additional procedure to get reasonable assurance that the financial data are not, you know, materially misstated, or our assessment of control is confirmed. This sampling risk is frequently expressed as a percentage. For example, there is a 1 in 20 chance, 5% of material error going undetected. Now, lots of audit firm has you know, fixed the risk, and it is acceptable to many of them. You know how now when we are doing sampling, our audit risk is equal to inherent risk into control risk, and detection risk is further split into sampling and non-sampling risk. So the equation is a bit enlarged. Can you go back? Okay. Now, risk is also expressed in the form of a confidence level and a reliability factor. Now, what is a confidence level? Confidence level statistically is the degree of assurance that material error does not exist. It is the opposite of risk. Okay? So normally statisticians use this confidence level. We go on a simple way of reliability factors are related to risk percentages, because statistically we are interested in beta type 2 error, that we are more concerned that our financial negative, I mean, that the financial statement are not materially misstated. Okay? So it's a way of saying that financial statement reflect true and fair view, but virtually we are concerned that our financial statement should not be materially misstated. So reliability factors, as I said, different terms have been used, okay, by different firms. The objective is simply to, as we have already discussed, to work out the size of the sample. What are the non-sampling risk then? Non-sampling risk is that whether you go for sampling or you don't go for sampling, it is always there. That is inappropriate audit procedures, misinterpretation of audit evidence, failure to recognize a misstatement or deviations. And examples are failure to investigate significant fluctuations and relationship while applying analytical procedures, placing reliance on management representations. We don't now, okay? after the clarified ISRs, the management representation has to be corroborated. Management, in a very, I will be going out of context if I deliberate upon it in detail, because that is not our subject at the moment. But the management representation, we make this error that we take on a management representation solely, whereas other audit evidences are expected to be available. So that is called, that is also an example of non-sampling risk. Selective testing is also subject to non-sampling risk. Why? Because here also we may select an inappropriate item. What we consider to be material may not be material, and we may ignore other items which are, though as far as the numbers are concerned, they are immaterial, but in substance they are material. You all know that sometimes the small payments may lead us to a material misstatement. Okay, that small payment might have been given as a bribe to conceal some material misstatement. So this is the error that we make while we are doing selective testing. So this is also a non-sampling risk. Non-sampling risk can also arise if the auditor fails to recognize an error in an individual sample item. And we all address this issue through proper planning and supervision and review. Now coming down to sampling approaches, here come. During the break, one of the gentlemen was saying, look, this sampling is a hassle. I mean, we can't do it. Yaar, ye kehte hain humse ke sampling karo. You know, how can we work out, this formulas and all that, or phir random numbers nikalo or tables nikalo, or kis tarah se ho sakta hai? So as I said very earlier, that is not compulsory. First of all, the audit sampling is itself not compulsory. Next, when we decide to do audit sampling, then even in that case, the statistical sampling is not compulsory. It is the approach as stated by ISA 530. You can do it statistical or non-statistical. What is a statistical sampling? Two characteristics are needed for a statistical sampling. Number one, your selection should be at random, and the result should be mathematically explained, including the sampling risk, the quantification of sampling risk. This is the primary requirement. If these two conditions are not met, either of them, then we cannot call it a statistical sample. Okay? Now there, a lot of technical knowledge is needed. Statistical knowledge is needed. It's not that difficult, but people avoid. And there are defects also in statistical sampling. I'm coming to that. I'm saying with all my authority and my understanding that non-statistical sampling gives you a better result than statistical sampling. How? We are coming to that. Non-statistical sampling approach, other than that, it's very simple. What is not this is all rest of the sampling is a non-statistical sampling. Why non-statistical sampling is widely used? Now we are coming down to that. First of all, ISA 500 permits us. It says use your common sense. Okay, cost of obtaining evidence and the benefit that you derive from audit evidence. It is less costly, less time consuming, but it can be just as effective and even more effective, I would say, than statistical sampling. The lower training cost of non-statistical sampling, it usually takes less time to learn non-statistical method than a statistical one. Because you see, we are running a firm with a team. If I am expert, I do not always expect that rest of the all people can do statistical sampling. And secondly, more importantly, whether statistical sampling is giving me a better result or non-statistical sampling. Whenever it's very common and it's very known that whenever there are complex method, whenever there are complex structure, it is indicative of high risk. It's always a high risk. Wherever you talk of anything, if the process is complex, there's a high chance of a risk. If we have a complex group structure spread over all over the world, there's a high, we can say there's a high order.